listening to
Thoroughly Kinky.
Thoroughly Kinky.
Thoroughly Kinky.
Thoroughly Kinky.
Thoroughly Kinky. Thoroughly Kinky.
With your hosts, Liam and Adam.
Blazing on a sunny afternoon.
So, welcome to a brand new episode of Thoroughly Kinky.
Yeah.
This episode is going to be all about the Kinks' 1969 release, Arthur.
Yeah.
Or, long title?
Arthur, bracket, or the decline and fall of the British Empire, close bracket.
There you go. Bit of a mouthful. As always, I am Liam. I am the Kinks' newbie. Every episode of this podcast, I listen to a Kinks album for the first time. We go chronologically. We're going to do all of the Kinks albums eventually. And to help me understand and contextualize, I have by my side my trusty co-host, Adam Smith.
Yeah, this is the first time, I think, since the first episode, I've not had the actual vinyl of this particular record. Instead, I've got 50th anniversary CD box set.
Adam is holding up to the webcam a very nice-looking box. It must contain quite a lot. What have you got inside that box, Adam?
It's got all the singles that came off this record. It's got a Dave Davies solo single as well. It's got postcards. It's got four CDs. It's got a poster. Yeah. What do you think of the album art of this one?
I think that this one looks very Monty Python.
Yes, it does. And
I said that like an American. Sorry, let me say that again.
Monty Python.
To me, it looks... Python.
Yeah.
To me, it looks very Monty Python.
Yeah. Interesting thing is, this came out in October 69, which is the same month the Monty Python debuted.
Ah, okay. So it's sepia-toned. We have a sort of endless horizon, an endless desert horizon with smoke, billowing smoke in the far distance. And right down the middle of the composition, you have a collection of very strange objects, a coffee mug with Arthur written on it, portrait of the band, a swan, a black kettle. Now it's like an eye test because right in the distance, like it's a house.
Little house, and there's a hand with the banner of the Kinks coming out of, like, it's almost like a sea of tea.
Ah, you see, I said it was like a desert.
The fact that the hand's coming out of it seems to suggest it's liquid, but, you know, it's a pretty surreal piece of art anyway, so. I think the cover would work better on vinyl and CD. I think it gets a bit lost on CD. The stuff just in a vertical line maybe isn't the best composition. It does reflect the very workaday contents of that the album deals with. This is not an album with glamorous subject matter. This is, you know...
It's kind of following on from the Kinks Are the Village Green Preservation Society, glorifying the ordinary.
I would say this album's a bit more real because it deals with actual historical epochs a bit more, so it's a bit more reality to it, whereas Village Green is a little bit fairy tale.
Yes, Kinks Are the Village Green Preservation Society is very much about the world of imagination, whereas this album seems to focus a bit more on the here and now,
yeah,
and the past.
And the past and real things. And do you know the background to this album, why this album came about?
No, I don't.
Well, you know how when we did the sort of bonus tracks from the Village Green era last episode, a few of them were from TV shows and one was from a film. Well, this was a commission he got for an entire TV show, which he would do the soundtrack for. The script's apparently missing, so no one knows exactly what was meant to go on it, but The story's like taking this sort of everyman Arthur and seeing him and his family from the Victorian era right up to date and going through both world wars.
Wait, but this was never made, right? It was only a script.
It ended up getting cancelled by ITV and only the album came out.
You know, I think this is a familiar story to a lot of musicians. They have creative friends and directors, and it's like, hey, I'm going to make a film.
Yeah.
You can do the soundtrack, but it all falls through in the end.
As you will recall, the Kinks have now been banned from America for 4 years, and their career is like,
yeah.
A lot of people assume they'd split up in America. They're sort of like first wave British invasion has-beens. Around about this time, the ban is lifted. They get the opportunity to get the ban lifted. Apparently, they had to just sign something.
Woohoo!
Yeah. So they get the opportunity to tour America for the first time since 65. This album came out at the same time. Reprise, their American label, gives it quite a big push. So
Wow. Suddenly
their tour in America doesn't become a huge hit, but it kind of becomes a cult hit in America, and it paves the way for a bigger comeback next year.
Bit of a risky choice to try and re-enter America with. It's not the most accessible album they've made.
Well, I think they were going for the Anglophile angle. I think that's what Reprise were promoting them as. This is an unashamed British album. Pick it up. It's the best. And it was getting really good reviews. It came out maybe a few months after Tommy by The Who. And I think it was maybe on the back of that a little bit. Because Tommy was a huge album in its own time. It was like, Americans who loved Tommy we're looking for another thing. Your next stop is Arthur. And it's so, I think it got a bit of the slipstream from that, you know, a bit, you know.
Supply and demand.
A little bit, yeah.
The Who had set the tone with Tommy. The Americans were connecting that and they were looking for that and it was marketed as such.
Yeah. You know, and then Americans were taking it very seriously, you know, and like, this is a meaningful album from these English geniuses.
So let's plunge into it. The first track, it's called
Victoria. Victoria!
So that was Victoria. I love this one.
Yeah.
What a great opener. So groovy, so complex.
Yeah, it's fantastic. One of the best songs ever. It's this really just opens up. This is the whole of the British Empire opening up in front of you, you know.
Right, because Victoria is Queen Victoria.
Yes.
Sort of the emblem of the British Empire.
Totally.
And lyrically, it's all about that colonial mindset.
Yeah, and it's... I've heard people interpret as celebratory of that and also condemnatory of that. And I think the genius of the song is that you can take it as both.
It's sort of ambiguous.
Yeah. It's a brilliantly just an anthemic song. You can't help but just be G'd up by it. And just it's because it's like gallops along in this sort of modified boogie sort of way.
Yeah. It's absolutely fantastic. So rhythmic, so powerful. Smasher.
I don't know what the TV show would have been like. I could imagine something that was like based around maps or across cosmopolitan views of India and stuff like that.
Right. The last LP starts with panorama of the village green, sort of a microcosm, whereas this is like a macrocosm.
Exactly, yeah. Last thing I'd say was, do you notice Ray's got quite a different singing voice on this?
How do you mean?
Well, it's quite different, and I think it's an impression of the singer from Canned Heat. They had a song Going Up the Country, and it's sort of sung in a similar sort of way.
A bit like how on the last album they did an Americana influence take on the good old-fashioned British steam train.
Yeah.
Here they're doing an Americana-drenched song about the British Empire.
Totally, yeah.
All right, let's move on to the next track, track number two.
Yes, sir, no, sir.
Yes, sir, no, sir. And your idol wishing you're outside and there ain't no admission to our play. Pack up your ambition in your own kit bag and you'll be happy with the back of the fag. Just don't stop again. Do what I say. Do what I say.
All right, that was the second track, Yes Sir, No Sir. Totally cinematic, You've got such a diverse set of chord progressions in here. I think it's them really giving Tommy a run for its money.
This is moving on a few more years, and this is World War One and how the working class troops were treated in that. And you'll notice he's putting on different voices. He's playing at least three different characters in this song.
Right, yeah, let's go through it. In the first verse, yes, sir, no, sir, where do I go, sir, permission to speak, sir? He's one of the working class grunts in the trenches.
Yeah, where do we go to? The sergeant major then would be, I guess, you know, the sort of checking out the troops, telling them off, would be the guy that was like chest out, stomach in, you know. And then if you go further into it, it's like you're going further and further back from the front line, I guess.
Oh, yeah, I really like this bit where it changes musically as well.
Yeah.
Gets a bit faster. Doesn't matter who you are.
Doesn't matter who you are. You're there and there you are. Everything is in its place. Authority must be maintained.
Would they be kind of upper class to the manor bred types, wouldn't they? Just sort of silver spoon types that are probably further back in the trenches. They're actually four different voices, because you got the guy who's like, make them feel that they're important to the cause. You know, that'd be the sort of people that'd be writing the death notices back to the wives and mothers, you know. Sort of, so sorry your son died kind of thing, you know.
It's pretty strong, yeah. Ray sings, give the scum a gun and make the bugger fight. And be sure to have deserters shot on sight.
Yeah, and I love that horrible posh laughter he does after that. It's very good acting.
Give the scum a gun and make the bugger fight. And be sure to have deserters shot on sight. If he dies, we'll send a medal to his wife.
It rewards continued listens. It's not easy listening, but it's enjoyable and
yep.
Not altogether a nice journey. Yeah.
I listen to these albums before we do the podcast. I always try and make sure to listen to it twice. The second time I listened to it, I got this one. But the first time, it seemed like a lot.
Yeah, totally. But they've never done a song like this before. This is progressing even on the more recent stuff. They're going beyond compact pop songs that are like amazing pop songs. They're taking it to another level of something different, you know.
Yeah. It's like there's a sudden new normal with this album. It's normal for songs to have very sudden changes and kind of evolve into a completely different song.
Yeah, totally. And also to be over 3 minutes long. Like, everything's expanded on this album generally. There's not only a couple of short songs on it.
Right. There's a couple of kind of epic length ones coming up towards the middle. Okay, so we should make our way there with the next track. It's called
Some Mother's Son.
Our mother's son lies in a field. Back home they put his picture in the frame. But all dead soldiers look the same. While all the parents stand and wait to meet their children.
This one's a really atmospheric ballad.
Yeah.
I like the low key way it opens with the harpsichord.
Yeah.
And as usual on this album, it never stays in one place for too long.
Yeah, I've been on a real journey with this one, because when I first heard it, I was 16 and I was definitely not emotionally mature enough to get this one. Mm. When I first heard it, it sounded a bit maudlin and caterwauly. Yeah. But as I've got older, I get it now, especially when you're a parent yourself and stuff like that. You know, the amount it really hits home, the way the different themes change and all that, you can almost see a story unfold in your head or how it would have been filmed on TV, you know.
Yeah, you've got a series of these very mournful scenes.
Yeah.
The parents coping with the tragedy and the aftermath.
Yeah, no, I think it's absolutely devastating, this song. You wouldn't want to listen to it every day, but in the context of the album as a First World War mourning individual tragedy song, it's peerless in pop music. This was a new thing. This is like a cinematic sounding pop song about this subject, and as such, it's peerless.
It absolutely achieves the emotional tenor it's setting out to achieve. A bit of a change of pace now, because the next track is
Drivin. Though the trouble was around us seems an eternity away, and all the debt collectors, rent collectors, all will be behind us, but they'll never find us, cause we'll be driving, 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 driving.
All right, that was Driving. As I say, a real change of pace because it's such a non-serious song after the last track. And it's so charming and welcoming, and it just captures that feeling of wanting to go on a road trip with your friends.
It's obviously it's a lighter change of pace after two very heavy songs. And that reflects the historical moment because this is supposed to be the interwar period, the 20s and 30s, where it's all Just William and Art Deco mugs and flappers and stuff like that, and it's a bit lighter and it's a bit of a burst of colour.
Yeah, this one's got a real, really kind of fun little do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do, kind of like a carefree, lackadaisical vibe to it.
Totally. But it's also a reminiscence of family trips in the car to the countryside that the Davies family used to go on. He was combining those two things. He was thinking that the interwar years were a bit more of a giggle, and combining that with fond memories of his own childhood.
Wait, so he had memories of road trips with his family?
Yeah, in the 50s, yeah.
Okay. Would that make them quite a well-off family?
They were really quite working class, although they're a big family. So there was 8 children, there were 6 older sisters. Some of them were quite a bit older than the Davies brothers. They might have had jobs, been independently wealthy. I don't know where they... They were working class, but aspirational working class, I think.
Sort of like upper working class sort of a situation.
Yeah. It was a single. It flopped. It got nowhere.
Oh, yeah. Okay, I'm surprised it was a single. Well, kind of surprised, kind of not, because this album doesn't have much in the way of single material.
Although, strangely, it had 3 singles taken off it.
Right, okay, so they tried hard.
Yeah.
Was this the least successful of the 3 singles?
There was 2, including this one, that didn't chart at all. The 3rd one was Victoria, and that was a minor hit.
All right, okay, let's move on from Drivin' now and onto the next track, which is called...
Brainwashed.
Brainwashed.
Yeah.
What a mad little song this is.
Yeah? What's your first take on it? Mad little song, yeah?
Yeah, it's kind of mental. Like, I love this little descending lick of the melody, sort of twinned with the guitar. Halfway through, it changes into a completely different song again.
Yeah.
You've got these kind of like crazy power chords here.
Yeah.
It sounds really fresh, modern.
Yeah.
It's kind of all about... I don't know, it's ranting about something in the lyrics.
I don't know how it breaks down, but I think it's a few members of Arthur's family. This is someone who leans more socialist, I think, ranting against possibly Arthur, saying he thinks he's got all these petty bourgeois sort of things, but it's just what the government or the man wants you to have, and you're not allowed anything else kind of thing, you know. It's a kind of pub argument.
Right, okay. So, like, the rantiness of the character is sort of replicated in the power chords they use.
Yeah.
And the lyrics as well. To them, you're just a speck of dirt.
Yeah.
You're just brainwashed.
Yeah. One of my favourite things is like unsexy, sort of boring sounding, workaday technical lyrics, but set to a really driving or a really sort of a powerful rock tune. And one of my favourite bits happens in this song like that, which is goes, They give you social security tax-saving benefits that grow at maturity. I just love it. I think it's so inherently hilarious singing that over such a driving rock song.
Sort of like proto-rap in
yeah.
a way.
Yeah. Got to give a shout out. I'm not a great expert on drumming, but I think this is generally considered to be Mick Avery's sort of apex as a drummer. He really complements each song really well, and he's got this sort of loose but also always in the pocket style, which is really complements songs like this incredibly well. He's the star of this album musically, I would say, you know.
Right. Well, he's the one sort of announcing all these big changes in these songs.
Yeah, totally.
So when there's a real change of pace, it's him that's leading that.
Yeah. They played this one live a lot. It's obviously just a groove that works really well, you know.
Right. Yeah. And while we are talking about band members, at the beginning of Some Mother's Son, I heard a bit more harpsichord that was so familiar from the last three albums. But I'm feeling like there's less harpsichord in this album overall.
Yeah, because Nicky Hopkins had left, and apparently Ray plays all the keys on this one. Because Ray could play keys, just not as, he wasn't as accomplished. You know, maybe you can hear that more, that it's a bit more basic.
There's a funny narrative forming in my head where Ray Davies writes the song Session Man
yeah.
about Nicky Hopkins, sort of saying he's just a session man. He's like a robot, basically.
Yeah.
Nicky Hopkins leaves and goes on to much bigger and greater things,
yeah.
including playing with the Stones and the Beatles. Yeah. Am I wrong?
Yes, you're right.
And then Ray Davies is like, I could do it myself.
Yeah.
But kind of gives up once he realizes that it's not his forte.
It still does the job, you know.
It's the job, yeah. I really liked his playing on Some Mother's Son.
Yeah. One more thing I should say is that lineup changed. John Dalton's come back.
Now, remind me, John Dalton.
Peter Quaife promised to lead the Kinks. So he was absent from the Kinks for about 5-6 months in 66. During that time, John Dalton fell in for him.
Oh.
And then Pete Quaife comes back and says, actually, no, I don't want to leave the Kinks. So John Dalton unceremoniously just gets cast aside.
He interned at the Kinks.
Yes, he was a temp, and then he came back 3 years later.
Well, worse than that, he was told he would be given a full-time job, but he didn't pass the probationary time.
Well, it was more like the original guy wanted to come back, and they accommodated him, but then Pete Quaife got fed up, as he was the one that was kind of least on board. With the Kinks, Ray was very dominant. Mm. He gave Dave a little bit of leeway because Dave was his brother, so Dave got some songs on the album. Pete Quaife was also a creative guy, but he said this in interviews, he was not getting anything on the album.
Right. Okay, he was being blocked.
Yeah, he just generally felt he wasn't able to express himself, so eventually he got fed up and left again, and they got John Dalton back.
Let's cross the bridge to the next track. What's it called?
It's called Australia.
So if you're young and if you're healthy, why not get a boat and come to Australia?
So, closing side one of the vinyl is the epic Australia.
Yeah.
And I really like this one, except for how it goes on a little bit too long with the solo, I think.
Right. I don't mind the end bit, but it's a bit different for the Kinks because they're not really known as a sort of jam band. I think that works for two reasons. One, it's at the end of the side, so you can play a bit more with time that way. And also, I think it gets across how overwhelming Australia was as a frontier, as this big, huge country.
Mm.
You know, didn't mention it before, but Arthur the character was kind of based on Ray's brother-in-law, Arthur, who married his sister Rose, and they actually emigrated to Australia in the early 60s. which is part of where the inspiration for this song comes from, obviously.
Yeah, there was a song on a previous album, I forget which one, but it was about Ray's sister leaving and emigrating to Australia.
Rosie, Won't You Please Come Home? Yeah, that's another song about the same subject, yeah.
Right. I think this song really conveys, as you said, the vastness of Australia, yeah, and then the giddy excitement of, yeah, Australia as a land of opportunity, like a second new world. I mean, the way he sings it, it's almost like he's a jolly little elf.
Yeah, totally. It's like a tourist board advert, really, isn't it?
I think there's a lot of sarcasm to some of the lines.
Oh, you mean like everyone walks around with a perpetual smile upon their face? Yeah, that's a bit strong, isn't it?
I was thinking more of the lyric, was it? Australia, no class distinctions. Australia, no drug addiction.
Yeah, okay, there's a lot of sarcasm in it. But it's also a bit like Victoria. It's also kind of celebratory at the same time. You know, it's not totally, it's kind of both at the same time, I think.
Yeah, and there's like a kind of a Beach Boys feel to the kind of chorus part. We'll surf it up like they do in the USA.
We'll surf like they do in the USA. We'll
So here we have a little pause while we flip the vinyl disc over to side two. We're opening with
Shangri-La.
Shangri-La.
Sit back in your old rocking chair. You need not worry, you need not care. You can't go anywhere.
Wow, Shangri-La. What an explosive way to open the new side. This song has two sides. I love them both. It's got this quieter, folkier side.
Yeah.
And it's got this more bombastic side. It definitely feels like the centerpiece of this album.
Yeah, it definitely is. It's another huge epic. Got a smaller sort of focus, but it's still no less epic. It's about the ascension into the lower middle class. You've struggled up, but where do you go after that? Once you've got your own little English in this home and this castle kind of thing.
Yeah, it's kind of taking the mundane and giving it an epic quality.
Yeah, very anthemic, but it's also quite biting.
Right, and somehow amid all this, there's also this kind of moment of quiet in it that I really like.
Yeah.
These lovely chords here. In the midst of all extremes, it's got this really nice tender interlude I like.
I would think that'd be like the main character Arthur looking in his back garden. Meanwhile, there's all the just stresses of maintaining this lifestyle going on outside kind of thing, you know.
Right. There's a sort of a feeling of my house is my castle.
Yes.
It's my safe space. Yeah. But then there's all the pressures that are involved in keeping a household together.
Yeah. But it is kind of existential. It's that kind of talking heads once in a lifetime. I've got all this, but what does it all mean, really?
Yeah, totally.
You know.
Yeah. When Ray Davies sings the main refrain, Shangri-La,
yeah.
Shangri-La, it sounds like a cry of despair or something.
Yeah.
This is everything I've been waiting for to get in life, but is it enough?
Yeah. This was also a single. This also bombed.
Wow. Surprised it was a single. I think it's great, but it's not the most accessible track in the world.
I'm not surprised it flopped. It's too subtle of a theme, really, to get across, I would say, even though it's like catchy and anthemic bits. But I guess you had epic long songs at the time, like MacArthur Park by Richard Harris.
MacArthur's Park is melting in the dark. All the sweet green icing flowing down. cake out in the rain.
What it most reminds me of is The Who, Tommy, because of this lovely horn accompaniment they have.
Yeah.
It reminded me a bit of John Entwistle. Who had this big concept for a story for an album, Tommy, but they also had big accessible smash hits like Pinball Wizard.
Yeah, this isn't that. This isn't accessible that way. Great song, great epic song, but I can see why it flopped as a single.
This album as a whole definitely seems like much more of a cult classic.
Yeah.
Even more so than Village Green. Moving on. What is the next track album?
Mr. Churchill Says.
We shall defend our island on the land and on the sea. We shall fight them on the beaches, on the hills and in the field. Well, Mr. Churchill says we gotta hold up our chins, we gotta show some courage and some discipline. We gotta black out the windows, nail up the doors, and keep right on to the end of the war.
Right, so Mr. Churchill Says definitely goes in the weird category for me.
Yeah.
It's using the words of British wartime Prime Minister Winston Churchill.
Yeah.
It's this rocky, bluesy song. And it seems like Ray is doing a sort of Churchill impression, sort of a wobble, not a close impression.
Yeah.
I like its energy. Probably one of the slighter tracks on this album for me, though.
It's not one of the better epics. There's enough going on in it musically that I'm not bored by it, but I'm not totally convinced by the semi-spoken Churchill quotes. I've always wondered if an actual World War II veteran or someone that was around then heard that at the time, what they would have thought of it, whether it would have come across as horribly disrespectful or not. I'm not sure. You know?
It does sound sort of insolent,
yeah,
given the veneration that Winston Churchill had during his lifetime and after.
Yeah.
It kind of sounds superficially like he's making fun of Churchill.
Yeah, it sounds a bit glib, but they needed a World War II song, I guess, and this was the World War II song, but I don't think it rises to the heights of the World War I songs.
It seems to be like borrowing a trick from the last couple of songs as well, of having like a strong power chord section,
yeah,
which kind of comes out of nowhere. But it feels a bit familiar at this point.
Yeah.
Okay, so moving swiftly on, what is the next track?
She's Bought a Hat Like Princess Marina.
She's bought a hat like Princess Marina's, to wear at all her social affairs. She wears it when she's cleaning the windows. She wears it when she's scrubbing the stairs. Like Princess Marina, and her neighbors think it treats her a treat.
But she hasn't any food in the larder, nor anybody else in the street.
So she's brought a hat like Princess Marina. He's turning up the farce and the comedy up to 11. Lyrically, a complete piss take of the upper classes. Musically, it's sort of everything but the kitchen sink. Kind of harpsichord, sort of twee tea party sort of verse. And then
yeah,
you got this sudden burst of energy
halfway
through. I don't know, kind of wacky and circus-like. It's not one of the better songs on the album, but I think it represents a lot of the qualities of the album.
Well, I really like it, but as I say, I'm more into the sort of sillier music cog sort of stuff. But I don't agree it's a piss take of the upper classes, because it's got a sort of sadness to it. It's about aspirational working classes who try and ape the upper classes.
Oh.
By doing surface things like wearing similar hats and whatnot, you know.
Right, because like there's a line, he's bought a hat like Anthony Eden's, British Prime Minister again, because it makes him feel like a lord. I presume that was an upper class person trying to fit in with his peers.
And Princess Marina was a sort of minor member of the royal family, the sort of Greek side, who was about then as well. So this is definitely, we've moved on from the 40s to the 50s here. And this is the sort of time they would remember, even now, as a working class family growing up in the 50s. This is them remembering probably being working class and being aware of these sort of upper class celebrities of the time. And yeah, no, I think there's a sadness behind this song. The unspoken or kind of spoken thing is that these people are dirt poor and they have to make their entertainment where they can.
Right. I defer to your interpretation because it makes a lot more sense than mine. But I guess the way he's singing it is in this over-the-top, put-on, posh accent, which I suppose is making fun of this bad faith aspiration to be someone you're not.
Yeah, but I think it's like all the best songs of this album. I think it's celebratory as much as the piss take. When you get to the end and they're doing the whole street party, knees up, Mother Brown bit, it's sort of kind of also going for the full, we're here, might as well enjoy it kind of thing. You know, it's got a bit of that going on, you know.
We're approaching the end of the album now. Yeah. What is the next track?
It's Young and Innocent Days.
It was great, so great, young and innocent days. I wish my eyes could
This is a really tender song.
Yeah.
It's touching, it's moving. I like the doubled up vocals here. I presume that's Ray and his brother Dave.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, it's a comforting song. It's like a sort of a lullaby in a way. Wouldn't be surprised if Ray wrote this for one of his daughters.
Yeah, I'd agree. It is a poignant song. It's one of the few... In fact, it's probably the only song that doesn't really have much to do with the plot, particularly. You could take this one in isolation, unlike most of the rest of the album.
Right, yeah. We're not progressing through time on this track as we have been previously.
Not really. It's the outlier in this album because everything else kind of plays with characters or it's epic or sort of proceeds like a lullaby. It's got a middle section, but it's very much... It's on a different plane than the rest of it, really.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, on this album, it's definitely the odd one out with not having a kind of a crazy ramped up, souped up section that never repeats again. It's pretty much what you get in the first verse a few times over.
Yeah.
So, but there's nothing wrong with variety. I kind of like it on the album. Not one that's super memorable, but also one that's not bad.
Yeah, okay, I'd go with that. Yeah.
Okay, good. Nailed it. All right. So we're on to now the last two tracks of the whole album.
Yeah.
What's the penultimate track?
Nothing to Say.
Oh, well, I'll say it then. Oh, it's called... it's called Nothing to Say.
Those happy days we spent together. You keep pretending that everything
right, nothing to say. This is a great showcase for the whole band.
Yeah.
It's a really tight track, yeah. And like the little guitar fills and stuff. Yeah, it's like really sparky and electric and basic song in its structure. Yeah. But I think in the performance, that's what really makes it.
Yeah, this is quite often kind of considered one of the more minor pieces on it. I think it's quite unusual because in most of the other songs about family and stuff like that, you get a lot of affection and a lot of love coming through. This one's quite cynical about family. It's sort of saying, it's almost quite a modern perspective. It's like no one's actually getting in common at the end of the day. You know, children grow up and they've got nothing to say to their parents and they live in separate lives, you know. It's quite a surprisingly cynical song about family coming from Ray, I would say, you know.
Right, okay. Yeah. Well, I'm not surprised that it's cynical because it being Ray, but I guess you're right that when he writes about family, normally he's got a tender spot for that subject. Whereas here, it's sort of portraying adult child parent relationships as kind of just a laundry list of boring small talk about life insurance, trade union, independence in this case.
Yeah, I don't know. I got to admit, I think the album dribbles away a bit, a little bit at the end, which, you know, because I don't know, there's...
Well, I think the problem with this album that I had is that it peaks a bit early.
Yeah.
When you've got Australia, you've got this kind of 1-2 punch of Australia at the end of the first side and Shangri-La at the beginning of the next. It sort of hypes you up for this big, epic journey. But now we're at the end of the journey, the wheels are starting to fall off ever so slightly.
Yeah, it doesn't end. Is it bathos, they call it? It doesn't end with an epic, though it's got a lot of epics on it, but it doesn't end epically, really.
Maybe it's intentional, then, the way you're saying it. With bathos, it's like Shangri-La is the dream, the epic dream of the empire, and this is the reality of the average citizen of the empire.
Yeah, totally, yeah. Yeah, and I do quite like it, but it's like, it's always felt a bit to me like, this is the way this is ending. I know it's the penultimate track, but kind of the next one has always felt like the song you play over the credits.
Yeah, right. I mean, the last track should be reserved for a real banger.
Yeah.
So let's have a listen to it. What is it?
Arthur, the title track.
Arthur was born just a plain simple man in a plain simple working class position. The world was hard and its ways were set. He was young and he had so much ambition.
It's a real, it gets stuck in your head. Yeah. It's a real earworm, as the Germans say. Could have, sort of overly long, though, I think, over 5 minutes. It lacks the invention that's all over this album.
Yeah.
And it also lacks that epic quality that makes this album a real standout in my mind, in the discography. It's a bit of a weird one, hard to categorize. Definitely a lot of fun, but... I can't say I like it much better after a few listens.
Yeah, well, I think I'm assuming probably this was designed to have credits over it, you know, because it kind of works that way.
It definitely seems like it's really good for a kind of catchy theme tune for a TV show, which explains the premise of the sitcom, which it definitely does in the first couple of lines here.
It's actually kind of more like a sitcom theme than some of the stuff he wrote for Where We're Spring and stuff like that.
Yeah, that we did on the last podcast, those seem like more fleshed out songs, whereas this sounds more like a jingle, catchy theme tune.
I like it for those reasons. I do actually, I've got a lot of affection for this, because it has a lot of affection for its subject. It's like, it has that sort of theme tune likability. And it's interesting, Dave sings the first bit of this. I didn't realise that for years. I just assumed it was all Ray singing, but Dave sings the first verse.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I'm surprised because I'm used to Dave having a bit more of a raspy voice.
Yeah, it's... So, and there's very much a sense that the brothers are singing together, they're all on the same page with this because they're singing about a family member.
It's very likable and charming.
Yeah. There's a lot of affection in this song and it's very lovable, but it's also... You're also a bit like, that's it, you know, after so many epics, you know, I don't know. Yeah.
Well, it's definitely a real fun one to end on. Kind of like summarises the... modus operandi of this concept album.
Yeah.
And it's just a lot of fun to sing along with. Arthur was just a simple man. I can't sing this, it's out of my range. Arthur was born in...
Arthur was born just a plain, simple man.
Simple man, yeah. In a plain, simple working class position. Yeah. Though the world was hard... Wait.
Though the world was hard
and its ways were set, he was young and he had so much ambition. It's a real pity it was never made.
Yeah.
Alas. I would suggest it would have made more sense to end on Victoria, which has a real epic quality, and to begin with this song, Arthur, to sort of set the stall and sort of explain who the hell Arthur is anyway.
Yeah, that could be, apart from the time thing, because Victoria's kind of set in Victorian times, but I still think, actually, you might be onto something there. They could have made it work.
Right, yeah, I think that would have worked better even if it had broken the chronology. Yeah. So we've made it to the end of 1969's Arthur. I've thoroughly enjoyed it. It's so different, it's so fresh. It's really exciting for me to see where they go from here, whether they retain aspects of the earlier Kinks sound or whether they carry on going in this more experimental direction. Yeah, just wondered if you could tell me, where does this album stand among your average fan's appraisal?
Yeah, it's up there. I think with a lot of people, it's like after Village Green, this is the next one they go to. Because it's quite a focused concept album, but they did a lot more concept albums in the 70s, and I don't know, they're different anyway, it's hard to say, but this one seems quite tight compared to the concept albums they did later on. This one's, you know, quite relatively digestible, but it's also got quite interesting song structures and stuff like that, you know.
Yeah. I feel quite safe saying that I do prefer Village Green overall, all things considered. I think it's a more consistent album. I think the small setting of it's very charming, whereas with Arthur, it's sort of mock heroic, kind of grandiose at times, but is not sure how much it's taking itself seriously.
Yeah.
And so for that reason, I put them both in the same box, both really good albums. I slightly prefer Village Green.
Yeah, it's definitely a very singular album in the discovery. There's no one quite like it for a start. This is the only album made by this lineup. There's a four-piece, but with John Dalton. It's quite singular for those reasons I said above, like the epic song structures, but still in that kind of four-piece band lineup.
Right, with the horns and the harpsichord and lots of different elements all in one song. Yeah. It's definitely a very memorable album and one that rewards repeated listenings.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's it for our podcast today. But next time, tune in again when we're going to be listening to...
another one with a long title. It's Lola versus Power Man and the Money Ground.
Right, so part one of Lola versus Power Man and the Money Ground.
Oh yeah, part one.
That is actually part one of one, right?
Yeah, there is no part two.
Just a bit of a perverse name there. We'll delve into that next time, listeners. So, until then, stay kinky.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Thoroughly Kinky.
If you'd like to send us an email, we'd love to hear from you.
Write to us at thoroughlykinky@gmail.com.
You can follow us on social media too.
You'll find all the links in the description. So that's all from us.
See you next time on
Thoroughly Kinky.